Hi there, everybody. This is Sean for Steam Cuisine, bringing you another episode of Steam Cuisine. Playing Dark Souls 2 again, Scholar of the First Sin. I think last time we had just got into this castle, and we had talked to the lovely lady here and got ourselves a key to the smithy and came back. We're going to continue on. Got a nice episode for you today, talking about the, I guess, pitfalls of cooking and the traps that lay in wait for people new to cooking and even experienced veterans, and how we can avoid those traps. And we're also going to be doing a little talk about rice. So, we already got somebody coming after us. Let's see if I can remember the controls. Yep. Okay. Still remembering the controls pretty well. So, yeah. Ooh, wow. So, when you first approach cooking, there's a lot of stuff that tends to get in the way, and stuff that is not explained well to the layman. For example, a lot of recipes refer to techniques with single words that don't explain what that technique is. And this can lead to abject frustration and failed cooking recipes. And that just makes you not want to cook because you don't understand what went wrong because they don't explain what you needed. For example, a recipe might be like, you need Frenched onions. And it's like, well, what is a Frenched onion? What do you mean? And this door does not open from this side. I forgot what I need to do here. Frenched onions are just onions cut in a specific way, but they're never going to tell you that it's just a cut of onion. And I'm guessing that you end up running into these issues where you're stuck. Now, luckily, we live in the age of Google, where we can look up stuff and, like, you can get away around it. But if we basically build up a vocabulary, we can end up avoiding these traps. Knocking. Anybody? Let's punch the door. Think this? Come on, open the door. In the old game, you could punch this door and the people inside would open it. Guess that doesn't work anymore. Okay. So we were talking about being trapped. Oh, you're a bad guy. Yep. Oh no. Yeah, dead. Another trap we get into is thinking we have to do a really fancy meal to impress our friends, and we have to follow these really intricate recipes with all these expensive ingredients, or we're not cooking, and what's the point? When you start cooking, don't start cooking with the most intricate, expensive recipes. You're looking to have... Oh, nope! You want to have recipes that you're not going to feel bad that you messed up. You want to start with basic recipes, things that cheap, potatoes, rice, pastas, because when they get messed up, if you end up somehow making them inedible, you aren't chucking $30, $40 out the window. Oh, I'm getting thrown stuff at. Get up here. Oh, hi, Iron Guy. And that can be a big help. Ooh. And the other thing is, don't be afraid to fail. If you don't fail, then you're a savant, and you're better than the rest of us combined. Come on, get up. I keep overextending. Don't do that. Come on. You got him. There you go. Good job. So, like, for example, learn how to make mashed potatoes. Start there. If you are looking for advice and help, You can look for my beginner's guide series. My beginner's guide series has a lot of good starting recipes. And if you start there, you can then branch out into the expensive stuff, and like you'll be so much more proud of yourself when you do a really difficult recipe and succeed on the first try because you worked your way to it. One of my favorite examples of like biting off too much was when I was younger. I, for some reason, for my birthday, oh, ow! For my birthday, wanted to cook a leg of lamb, a butterfly leg of lamb. And a butterfly leg of lamb is not a simple task. Like, you can end up getting yourself into some deep, deep trouble with something that difficult. And I have to say, oh dear Lord, where did you come from? Run from bomb guy. I luckily back then, before internet, ended up having a cookbook called The Idiot's Guide to Cooking. And that allowed me to have a very straightforward recipe for my butterfly leg of lamb. Now I can hear what you guys are saying. It's like, oh, well, I can look up recipes online. There's a difference between recipes printed online and recipes printed in a book. That a printed recipe in a book had to be vetted by somebody because a publisher, oh, no, we need. Yeah, that's fine. I'm not fighting that. A publisher had to like vet those recipes. And that way they had to like, oh, we want to make sure that these recipes actually function. And good, he left. We want to make sure that these recipes actually function because if they don't, we can end up getting like negative reviews for our books. And that can lead to us getting like the next book will not sell, even if it's good. So they make test kitchens and will like check out each recipe, and I will die horribly to night combo. You die. Play carefully. Life gem. And that way that you have like a sense that these recipes are tested. Online recipes, no such thing. You could have recipes, even by like trusted sources, be published and they just have wrong information and they are not tested and they're just up there to fulfill like a quota for why are you throwing bombs? Just to fill a quota of like articles and recipes. So I suggest go to your local library, go to the cooking section of your local library, and you will find numerous cookbooks that you can lend out freely. Or you can even go to like they call them like friends of the library type stores in bigger libraries where they have for sale used books that the library no longer wants to keep in stock. And you can get like old cookbooks for a song. Like $1.50 for some really good cookbooks. A lot of my Julia Child cookbooks come from this, from the Friends of the Library. I suggest looking into cookbooks like, what is the book called? It's What Einstein Told His Cook. What Einstein Told His Cook is a wonderful book talking about the science behind cooking and the physics of it. It's a cookbook done by a physicist. Do we have a little bomb? Don't know if a witching urn lights those on fire. Yeah, it says it explodes. So let's try it out. I think that there's a crack there that has something in it. So, Chuck. Nope, does not explode the way I want it to. I need, what's his name? Oh, I know what I was supposed to do. Okay, we'll have to come back. So yeah, that can lead to to your steps to encouraging your cooking talents versus stifling them with failures. The other thing I got taught really early on was that, oh, you have an arrow, is that your failures are still edible. Like, just because something tastes not as good as it could have been does not make it a worthless thing. Like, it's not a waste. Like, yeah, I over-seasoned my mashed potatoes. They're probably still okay to eat. They're just not probably the best. Or you under-season them, they're still probably edible. Like, they're not the best. But that allows you to have still a decent meal and not be wasting food. Another trap tends to be overbuying of ingredients. Like, if you end up buying ingredients for a recipe, you end up buying more than you need, and then you don't know what to do with the leftovers. Always have like a plan for your ingredients when they're left over. I swear I had a torch somewhere. Is it in my offhand? No. Do they just not give you a torch anymore? Oh. I don't remember how to use a torch, and I need to. Oh, just chug that Estus. Estus. I think I can. Oh, that's right. You press Y to toggle it. Light this torch. I have an idea. So yeah, like have a pl what I'm getting at is you should have a plan for your like leftovers. Like if you end up having a something that uses potatoes and you end up having to buy like it's just cheaper to have like an extra pound of potatoes, be like, "Oh, I know I want to oh, ow. I know I want to cook something with potatoes later in the week because that is going to give me the best use of my ingredients." So just an ounce of planning can lead you to success. Let's kill this guy and then we'll light this thing. Whoa, what? No. Oh, I've lost connection to Steam. Okay, that's fine. Whatever. So if I no, wrong button. There we go, set light. Is this gonna work? Oh yeah! For an axe guy to come eat my face. Whew. And that gets to like one of my other topics today is talking about mise en place. Mise en place is the idea of French cuisine that if you have everything in the proper place, that you can work more efficiently and that you will not be messing up your recipe because you suddenly forgot that you need to dice up a clove of garlic or that you need to suddenly, oh, I forgot I needed to truss up the meat before I put it in, but now my ingredients have already started cooking, and by the time I tie it up, they've burnt. So if you have everything mise en place, which is to have everything in its place, you can then work with like the knowledge that you have everything prepared. It's that ounce of preparation rule coming back. And that means like get everything done that can be done before you start. So I'll dice the onions, I need to dice my carrots, I need to dice my garlic, truss up my meat, and then when I have everything set up and measured and everything, I can then begin. And if I do so, I can then work with perfect clarity of oh yeah, like I ended up okay, come on, spear guy. You can then work n with the proper order of things, and it will go a lot smoother. A lot of people, oh, I forgot they can do that stupid move. A lot of people describe cooking as like, oh, I'm like running around with a chicken with my head cut off. Those people do not prepare properly. And that is what leads to this chicken head cut off maneuver. So if you just a little bit of prep, a little bit of thought, gonna go a long way. So I did promise somebody that I would talk about rice. So, no, not at my feet. Throw it here. Right in my face. Good toss. Come on. Give me a nice hard toss. You! Well, now you've messed it all up. Come on! I don't want to die to bomb. Come on. Do I still have the torch lit? No. But that'd probably be really dumb. I could end up blowing myself up really easily. Ow. So as I said, I need to talk about rice. So somebody asked about how to make rice without a rice maker. And they said that theirs always comes messed up, and that leads to their struggling and oh, get off this roof. Come on. Come on, guys. Okay, bomb guy came down, did he? Maybe. Will he throw bombs down here though? Yeah, so what you need to do is decide what kind of rice you need to make, and then you can make a decision on how you're gonna die by these soldiers. Ooh. So for standard white rice, I should have seen that coming, and that's gonna end up me dead. So for standard white rice, usually you're gonna look at medium grain rice or long grain rice. Rule of thumb is 2-to-1 on your ratio, which means for 1 cup rice, you will use 2 cups water and a pinch of salt. If you are making more than 2 cups of rice, you need to look into the ratios of rice because the ratios get kind of funny the more rice you make. It actually ends up becoming less rice, less water per additional rice. So, for example, I believe that 3 cups of rice end up getting cooked in not 4 cups, but 3 3/4, which is weird. And then it gets crazier the more you go up. You'll eventually end up like cooking in almost even amounts of water and rice, which is bizarre. So what we're going to do is we're going to start with a medium saute pan. Oh, that was dumb. A medium saucepan, sorry, I'll correct myself. A medium saucepan, and we will be making sure that it has a tight fitting lid. Our second piece of hardware is that we are also going to be taking a we'll also be taking a piece of aluminum foil and measuring out twice the length of the circumference of our sauce pot. And we're going to fold it over so that we have a like foil lid to our pot as well. Now, I'm sure you're hearing me like, didn't you say I needed a tight fitting lid? And didn't he now just say that now I'm making a lid out of tin foil? You're gonna need both because what we're looking to do is to trap the moisture inside the pot without any of it escaping. Cooking rice is more akin to steaming than it is boiling or simmering or anything like that. So, got our tin foil, our pot, our lid, rice, water, bit of salt. Some families like add a pat of butter. I think that this can be, if you want it, you can add this at the end. And that will allow you to have like the southern butter rice thing. My girlfriend loves it. I don't. I'm a soy sauce guy. And so what we're going to do is we're going to put our rice and our water inside the pot and a pinch of salt. And then we are going to go ahead and put this over medium-high heat until it comes to a rolling boil. We don't want just simmering. We want this to come to a full boil. And what we want to do is we want to leave that at a heavy boil for about 5 minutes. And then we're going to turn it down to low, clamp on our foil, and then our lid. And we're going to let it sit on low heat for 10 minutes. And then we're going to turn off the heat and let it sit for another 15 minutes. And the secret is to not look at the rice. We'll never take those lids off until those times are complete. If we end up taking a look at this rice while it's cooking, we are going to let not only heat out, we're going to let moisture out. And this rice needs all the moisture in that pot because it's not just cooking it, it is rehydrating it. So if you take the water out, you won't have enough water to rehydrate, and that will lead to crunchy, underdone rice. So at this point, we have our rice going. And after the timer goes off for the cool down after taking off the heat, going to go ahead and take off the lids, and we're going to go ahead and take a fork and fluff the rice, which means we're not looking to stir, we're looking to like scrape and toss. If we scrape and toss, that makes much more sense. Let's buy two. We're going to go ahead and like scrape and toss so that our granules of rice stay separated, instead of, if you don't do this, they will glom onto one another in the surrounding starch, and they will basically turn into like sticky rice. Now, mind you, there is purpose to sticky rice, but for general white rice, we're not looking for the sticky quality. That's another episode. We can now know that we have our rice taken care of, and basically you can then use that for whatever serves your need. Whatever serves your needs. Ow, what shot me? Oh, there's a dude right there, Sean. Nice. That was really bad. Yeah, so you can then use this rice however you need. Sorry about all the ums. And I'm sorry for saying sorry. I've been trying to work on not saying sorry as much during these. Oh no! And it's just tough. So, we've talked about rice. Now, there are other methods to cooking rice that differ from this standard method. So you have things such as like rice pilaf, a very fancy restaurant term. Pilafs are cooked in such a way that you kind of are adding flavor to these ahead of time. Oh, stop that. During the cooking process to create like a flavored rice that has stuff in it. The difference with doing a... Doing a pilaf and doing standard rice is that a pilaf, you end up cooking the rice by itself for a little bit in a little bit of fat, then cooking it the rest of the way, rather than just putting rice in water and go. So the steps for this, same rice. What we're going to add to the ingredient list is we're going to go ahead and add... get out. We're going to go ahead and add 2 tablespoons of butter, 1/4 onion diced, nice and small, almost minced. Small dice. I need to get the shield guy. Maybe not. No! No! Don't want to die. Whoa! Tough fight. No! No, no bomb in the face. Okay, got two. Come on, come on. Gotcha. Okay. Woo! That was fun. So we've got our butter, we got our rice, we got our onion. And we're gonna go ahead and melt down the onion until foaming stops on medium low heat. And then we're going to go ahead and add our onion to this. And we're gonna lightly saute this onion in the butter for just a little bit. We're almost looking for more of a sweat than we are a saute. Just gonna do that for a little bit. And then we're gonna go ahead and add all of our rice. And we're gonna put this over medium heat. Excuse me. We're gonna go ahead and put that over medium heat, and we're gonna constantly stir this. Hey, dude, come on. Not coming? Oh, okay. I need to go to my inventory. We're going to add the rice, and we're gonna be constantly stirring this rice in this butter. And what we're looking for is like a gold patina on this rice. And that will it not only impart like a buttery flavor to the rice and a caramelized little bit of sweetness, it's going to partially cook the rice before we even add water or flavorful liquid. And that's what we're probably the biggest difference between, oh, the biggest difference between a pilaf and a standard rice is that you are then cooking the rice, then adding flavorful liquid instead of just water. And that allows you to have like chicken rice or beef rice. Oh, that's no, wrong button. Die. Give me your halberd. Give me your halberd. Nope. And that's going to change the outcome. And then you can add things like diced up veggies or meats and stuff like that. So the only big difference is that you can change the amount of water for an equal amount of chicken stock, beef stock, veggie stock, any of that stuff. And then cook the same way after you add the rice and get it cooked. You add the flavorful liquid and raise it to a boil, which should happen a lot faster because the rice is already hot. And that will clamp, and then we're going to cook it 5 minutes, so on and so forth. So that does it for today. I have to say thank you very much for tuning in. Thank you for everybody who has subscribed recently. I thank you so much. You guys are the reason I do this. If you would have any questions, comments, concerns, you can leave them in the comments below this video. You can also send me an email at steamcuisinelive@gmail.com, or you can subscribe to us on like us on Facebook at facebook.com/steamcuisine, and you can also check out our Twitter at steam_underscore cuisine on Twitter. And that will do it for today. And again, thank you for watching and happy cooking.